Ambolani Madikizela, a research manager, Water Research Commission in Pretoria. The reason why we are here is to demonstrate the sampling of macroinvertebrates using a tool called SASS. The whole purpose of developing SASS in the country, South African Scoring System, version 5, is to standardize the approach to sampling by all practitioners in the country and whoever is interested and is trained to take the samples and produce a report. It is very important to take samples properly, ensuring quality, because the quality of the report depends on the quality of the data on which it is based. Now this DVD is going to be produced and is here to standardize the way of taking samples and therefore ultimately producing reports. The data should then be comparable across the country. Right, the River Health Program is a component of a national monitoring program called National Aquatic Ecosystem Health Monitoring Program. Its focus is on rivers. This program has been in operation for about 16 years now, getting information through sampling using mainly SASS and other methods, reporting on the biological quality of water in the country to the managers in order to make a change on the ground. The River Health Program has used, as I said, SASS a lot, and that information is now sitting in the rivers database. We call it National Rivers Database. Most of it is based on SASS, through practitioners who are taking samples in the country and using that to report on the status and trends. The rivers database, as we have now, still needs to be populated with other indices, as we call them, such as those of fish and vegetation. But we are very happy that SASS at least is already on the database and is being used.
Hi, I'm Mark Graham, and here we find ourselves down on the Umzinduzi River in Pietermaritzburg, the home of the Duzi Canoe Marathon. And what we're doing today is looking at the SASS5 biomonitoring, rapid biomonitoring technique. This production is largely driven by the National River Health Program and the desire within that program to get standardization and ensuring quality control around the application of the various methods. It's been sponsored by the Water Research Commission, and really what we're looking at today is a review of the entire SASS5 protocol, from site selection, equipment, how to sample, all the way through to analysis of the methodology, and to try and ensure that in fact we have a solid, robust, standard method out there that anybody watching this production will be able to apply wherever they're working, and ensure that in fact the results that come out are really reflecting what's the health of the river and a water quality picture, rather than simply somebody's interpretation of the method, which may or may not be strictly correct. What is important to note today is that this is a production highlighting the key elements of the SASS5 rapid bioassessment methodology. For the full method and the detail for the different aspects of how the method's applied, one should really carefully consider the rapid South African Scoring System version 5 rapid bioassessment technique. Dickens and Graham published in the African Journal of Aquatic Sciences in 2002. That's the definitive methodology for the application of this method. So the advantages of the typical biomonitoring techniques, of which SASS5 is one of them, is that one can undertake these techniques with relatively little equipment. You don't need much to get into a river and start sampling. Once you've got your sample, it doesn't take too much to learn to identify these characters. The techniques are therefore relatively simple. And probably one of the key advantages is that once you've collected your sample, you come out with a very quick indication of the health of that system. What that's useful for is being able to then take that information and in the field actually investigate, look around and see where the sources of pollution might be coming from. It also has the distinct advantage of being able to integrate the entire water quality picture. So whether it's pH or conductivity or some other pollutant, it's picking up that total picture and giving us an indication of the health of that system. However, it's not a complete panacea for all monitoring. There are some disadvantages. It does have suffer the problem of not being able to clearly identify what the source of the pollution is directly. Is it a fecal sewage type pollution or heavy metals or chemicals and so on? It also doesn't necessarily tell you exactly when the pollution event took place, although it gives you some indication. It additionally is limited in cases where the flows might be such that you can't get into a river to sample it. And to some degree, it's also habitat dependent. If you need a reasonable range of habitats for the site to express itself and give the full opportunity to indicate what's at the site. But I suppose in summary, though, it is a bit of a red flag indicator. It shows us whether or not the river's healthy, and from there, one's able to continue and look around and perhaps use other chemical type means of investigating a pollution source or why a river's not healthy. Right, what we're next going to look at is what constitutes a good site. So it's what we typically call our site selection. And really what we want to do here is, the key thing is to select a representative reach of river which tells us something about this typical type of river within this part of the countryside. So if we looked at this river itself, we've got a weir upstream of where we're standing over there. And clearly that river is quite different to this rocky riffle type habitat here. So our site in this instance would start at that weir there and work its way down, probably about 50 odd meters down to this pool over here. And within that range would be our site that we'd be sampling today. And the important thing then is to choose a site that is representative of that particular reach of river that one is sampling. The things you need to look out for are to make sure that we don't have any other pollutant sources potentially coming into a site which would interfere with the water quality. So there might be a stormwater drain coming in off that bank, or a pipeline, or a sewer outfall, or something like that, which might affect the water quality at the site. So we want to be sure beforehand we've got a representative reach of river, no other pollutant sources. And then the other key thing, which we'll get onto in more detail just now, is are there available habitats at the site that we can use to sample, which are going to give us something of the story of this river and the health of this river. We're now getting ready to sample. Before we get in though, we want to be sure that it's safe to get into the water, and in fact we have all of our protective equipment and gear ready to do the sampling. Before we get in, we want to be sure, can we swim? Are you a fairly competent swimmer and not likely to drown in the water should you tumble over? Linked to that would be what dangerous or wildlife might be around in the place. Crocodiles, typically hippos, which if you're in a game park might be problematic, and you'd want to avoid those as well. So make local inquiries, check that there's none of those. Linked to the whole aspect of being able to swim would be having a decent life jacket on that will just help keep you up in the water should you tumble over. We've now got a pair of waders that serve two purposes. Firstly, the waders are helping us with keeping our legs dry, but additionally, if the water is polluted, we don't want to be standing in polluted water. Linked to that would be wearing a pair of gloves. Now those could be short surgical gloves, something like this, or the long sleeve gloves that would protect the entire length of the arm. So now we're clambering into the water, we've got our equipment, and we're off sampling. The old SASS net, very, very useful. This can provide a third leg, an additional support as one's crossing the river, stepping into the water, measuring the depth of the water before you put your foot forward, put the SASS net down, probe the depth and establish are there any holes there that you might sink into. But as you're crossing, particularly fast flowing water, the third leg of the SASS net just gives you that stability to help. should your foot become entrapped in the water at some point, very, very useful and essential, have a knife that you can open the knife and use that to, if necessary, cut away your boot or your waders to free up a leg that might be trapped in the water.
Well, what do you need to sample for SASS5? There's a minimal set of requirements, and it's part of the standardization process to ensure that we have the people collecting, or SASS practitioners using the same equipment, so the results that are coming out aren't related to variability in equipment, but we have the same equipment, so the results are more related to water quality. First thing, we need a net. Now, the standard SASS5 net is very strictly defined. It's a square opening. It's 30 by 30 each side. Beyond that, the opening is defined. The next requirement would be that the net is 1,000 microns or 1 millimeter, the pore size. Now, it doesn't matter what that material is, as long as that 1,000 micron is maintained throughout, that is the standard requirement for the SASS net. And that's really to allow the small organisms, which can't be seen by eye, to wash through, and the retaining the larger organisms that we want to be able to look at and identify. So there's our net. What else do we need? We've collected our sample, we bring it back, and we want to put it into something. In this instance, a tray is required. Put the sample onto, flush the net through with some water, flicking it out, bucket to wash some water through, clear water, as clear as possible. If it's from the site, you may have to bring water in with you if it's a really turbid river you're going to, so you don't sit with turbid water and you're struggling to identify, so have some spare water with you, clear water. But if it's a clear river, perfectly fine to use the river water. The sample's now on your tray, and you're ready to start identifying. Now, whether or not you have each of your three biotopes spread out on each tray doesn't really matter. You can process each biotope by itself. Again, that doesn't matter. Personal preference and where you find yourself and equipment available, costs, etc. The key thing next is you would require the standard SASS5 data sheet. And that has the families on it, the quality values, the different biotopes that you've sampled, where you would then record what you've located and found at this site. Other additional aids, which may be useful, not critical, and depends on experience and what your personal preferences, but would be the Aquatic Invertebrates of Southern Africa or South Africa field guides. This gives additional information on how to sample different habitats, and then something on the families. The other field illustration guidebook, very useful, and certainly when starting out, an essential piece of information of field kit to make sure you can always check up on things that you might not be sure of. The damselflies, some of their features might be a bit tricky, but having that book available just helps you confirm things in the field, and you're not dependent on bringing samples back necessarily to check up later. Those are the critical things. Other bits and pieces which make the identification process useful: a jeweler's loop or magnifying glass, just to help look at those facial features on things like the hydrocycids, the caddisflies, and other organisms in there. Very useful looking at particular aspects which just help with the identification. You'd usefully have a small sucker to allow you to suck up organisms, plunk them into your hand onto a further tray for further examination. A pair of forceps to pick things up, and perhaps, again, personal preference, but a small sucker with a little net on the end to help scoop out the organisms that you're looking for. Very useful, not essential, but almost essential because of the way SASS5 is structured, would be to get a small ice cube tray where it can be white or blue, a light color, allowing you to put particularly the betids and hydrocycids. And when you will have seen, or will see later in that section of this production, how to handle the betids and hydrocycids, the requirement to be able to distinguish between those particular species and the numbers of different species of those in your total sample. So because of that, we have the ice cube tray labeled with the stones column, the vegetation column, and the gravel, sand, and mud column, which allows us right at the end to look at the total number across the entire sample from our sample site. Then obviously, with all of that, you need a pencil or a pen to record your data onto your SASS sheet, a clipboard for that sort of thing. Other bits and pieces might be your on-site instrumentation, a clarity tube, a DO meter, and so on, a GPS to record your coordinates, and those sorts of additional things. Not essential, but useful additional material to have with you on-site.
Now, what links to the site selection is also making sure that the site we're interested in sampling has the full variability of habitats available for the aquatic organisms we'll be looking at. The principle here is that different organisms live in different habitats within the river. So if we look at a river like this, we can see that what we've got here is sort of rocky riffles and rapid type habitat, all the way down through to a pool type habitat. Additionally, on the side, we find that there's vegetation on the edge, riparian vegetation or marginal vegetation. So the important thing with the SASS methodology as it stands is there are three key biotopes. There's a stones biotope, there's the vegetation biotope, and there's the gravel, sand, and mud, or what's commonly referred to as GSM. GSM, gravel, sand, and mud. So three biotopes to look at. And why we're looking at the three different biotopes is that uniquely within those different biotopes will be different types of organisms, and those are the things we're going to be looking at later and identifying. What we're focusing on specifically now is the so-called stones biotope. Now that is the rocky riffle type habitat typically found in a river, not all rivers, but where it's present, it would be those rocks of a sort of from a 2 centimeters up to about 25 centimeters in size, and classically a cobble size, brick size rock that we'd be picking up, turning over, and seeing what organisms are in that and on that sample. There are two elements to this. It's the stones in current and the stones out of current. So if we look down towards the river and we look at that sampling being taken place now, we'll see Jean in the river, and he's making his way across to a riffle section at the end of that rapid, and he's going to start sampling for the stones biotope in there. The key thing there is that he holds the net sufficiently far from the where he's be sampling. The turning of the stones has to be very vigorous, so he'll be putting the net into the water downstream of him, and as he turns over the stones with his feet, the organism will be dislodged and will wash down into the net. He's going to avoid picking up the coarse sediments by having the net downstream, so it's really only the lighter organisms which will float down. The key element here is that he only samples for a total of 2 minutes. So in the process of setting across and working his way across the river, the fact that he's not sampling isn't included in 2 minutes, So it's only actual sample time that is recorded as a 2 minutes. However, there is a clause there, and that's really if in fact we find that the stones are largely bedrock or highly embedded, difficult to turn over, one can extend that time up to 5 minutes in total. You just need to note that time on your score sheet, indicating that you've gone over the standard 2 minutes of sampling of stones in current. What's important with all sampling and all biotopes is that we in fact range across the site. We don't want to be restricted to one simple area, a singular area, and sampling only there. So it's important to range both from the left bank to the right bank and also up and downstream of the sample site that we're working on. The last element of the stones habitat that we'll be sampling is what we call the stones out of current. So we finished with the stones in current, we're now moving to stones out of current if it's available at the site. Now that's characterized by stones which are generally cobble size, still 2 to 25 centimeters in size. They may be bedrock again as well, and they would be generally out of the current on the edge of the river. And what characterizes them really is the fact that they might have a fine silt sediment deposit sitting on the surface, but there's still slow moving water going over them. They're out of the main current, but they have that silt over the surface. And again, we'd work that, kicking across them, disturbing them, kicking over, turning them over with the feet, with the hands, rubbing them, dislodging anything that's attached to them, and then moving the net through there vigorously, picking up anything that is in the water column once the stones have been turned over and dislodged. The important thing with stones out of current is that we at most spend a minute sampling that particular sub-biotope of the stones. So in all, moving the stones, tumbling them over with the feet, moving with the hands over the surface, we've got a minute to complete that section. And again, ranging across the site, looking at a number of different stones out of current habitats, if they're available, we've got a minute to do that. What John is doing now is part of the hand-picking and visual observation aspect. He's hand-picking, picking up stones in the different habitats here. He's got stones in the current there, and possibly looking for things that he might have missed when he was doing the sampling with the net. He's now going into out-of-current areas, picking up stones there. Again, possibly missing things that might have been present there, but not caught in the net. The sorts of things we might expect to find there would be things like water pennies, tend to cling onto the rocks quite closely, and don't always get dislodged in the process of sampling using the net. The other things might be the freshwater sponges, which can't get dislodged at all, but are on the SASS form, and part of the protocol, but if we don't do the visual observation aspect, we just don't pick them up at all. Once we've finished our stones out of current sample, that gets combined with the stones in current sample, and that collective biotope of stones is analyzed together in one tray, and we'll look at that together in a little while. Some of the common errors which come through on the stones habitat sampling or stones biotope sampling would be that the stones are not vigorously or sufficiently vigorously turned over to allow the dislodging of the organisms which are clinging to those rocks, and often can be quite vigorously clinging. So important to turn the rocks and vigorously work them over with your boot or a hand to dislodge organisms stuck onto the rocks. The other thing is sometimes there's a tendency to go over 2 minutes, and it's just an enthusiasm, but important to stick to 2 minutes in total. The other key thing to remember and not forget in the sampling of the stones habitat, particularly stones out of current, is that you want to be making sure that the water that you're sampling is connected to the main channel, and you're not sitting in a backwater which has isolated water quality from the main channel that you're particularly interested in. The next biotope we're going to look at is the so-called vegetation biotope. So we've got the stones, vegetation and gravel, sand and mud. We're focusing on the vegetation here. And this really is that vegetation typically growing on the side of the river, the marginal vegetation. It may be either on the land and hanging with the leaves, etc., stems of the plant in the water, but it could also be on actually growing within the water itself, typically reeds, sedges and grasses and that sort of thing. Now the important thing here is that we've got a specified standard amount of effort required, and that is different to the others in that it is 2 linear meters. So that'll be 2 meters average height of a person, or somewhat tall person. Important with that is that we don't focus at 2 meters in one particular place. We rather take 0.5 meter in one type of vegetation that's growing there, another 0.5 meter in another type, go across to the other side of the river, look at another 0.5 meter there, and another 0.5 meter again. So in total, we have total 2 meters of vegetation sampled, and that would be vegetation both in the current, where there's lots of water growing, flowing past it, and also vegetation out of current in the pool sections, which are still within the main channel, part of the river and the water quality we're looking at, but with low flow, out of current type situations. Now to do the vegetation sampling over our 2 meters involves coming up with a SASS net and vigorously bumping up and brushing up against the vegetation to dislodge particular aquatic organisms that might be clinging to that vegetation. Typically our dragonflies and some of the water bugs. So we'd want to vigorously bump up against the vegetation, knock off the bugs and beetles and dragonflies and so on that are typically there, dislodge them, put them into the water column and sweep the net through and catching those individuals that are dislodged in our SASS net. The last element of the aquatic, of the vegetation we're looking at sampling is, would be that vegetation actually in the current and dependent on being in the water. So that would be typically the sorts of things like filamentous algae. It might be water hyacinth growing in the water with its roots hanging in and down in the water column itself. And we'd want to sample that lot and remove any particular bugs, beetles, aquatic organisms attached to that aquatic vegetation. That would be combined with the total vegetation sample, so which is vegetation in current and out of current, combine that with our aquatic vegetation, and that constitutes our vegetation biotope sample. The typical and common errors associated with the vegetation biotope sampling is that there can be a tendency at times to either undersample or oversample that 2 meter, standard 2 meter length. So important to stick with the 2 meters. The other thing is not ranging across the site, just choosing a single 2 meter length and sampling that alone. It's important to range across, up and down, look at also picking up different vegetation. It might be leafy vegetation, or it might be reeds, grasses and sedges. Important to go across all of those. Additionally, important not to forget the aquatic vegetation. Look around for that aquatic vegetation. It might be aquatic weeds, typical water hyacinth, kareba weed and so on, with their roots trailing in the water, constituting a habitat. Important to sample that. Right, the final biotope that we're going to be focusing on today would be the gravel, sand and mud. So we've covered the stones, we've covered the vegetation biotopes, now we're going to look at the GSM, gravel, sand and mud. Now typically that would be found in the slow moving water, where the energy of the water doesn't have the energy to carry the sediments, they start settling out, so that's the area we're going to focus on. In the main channel, gravel, sand and mud. Gravels are typically less than about 2 centimeters in size, and we're at the tail end of a riffle or below an island would pick up the gravels. The sand, on the other hand, would be less than about 2 millimeters, and classically we would know what a typical river sand would be on the edge of the banks, and combined with that one would be our mud, and that would be sand going through to fine silt clay type fraction, and we would be looking at that as well. Now the way to sample these would be to find these different biotopes, sub-biotopes as it were, jump into the river and, moving the boots vigorously, sweep the net through the disturbed gravel, sand and mud, and you've captured those organisms. The important thing there is to make sure that you, at the end of it, carefully wash through with clean water to flush out any fine clay fractions, which otherwise make it very difficult to look at in the tray when we come to identifying the particular organisms themselves. Some of the common errors associated with sampling the gravel, sand and mud are, firstly, to make sure you don't get too much gravel landing up in your net. So the way to do that is to work these gravels vigorously with your boots and allow the heavier sediments to settle out quickly and then sweep your net through that. And with practice, you'll get a feel of that. The other thing important to make sure you don't get big clods of clay sitting in your net. So wash through your net carefully at the end of it, at the end of your sampling, to wash out those fine clay fractions which otherwise cloudy the water. The overall sampling is strictly 1 minute in total, and all of those three sub-biotopes, the gravel, the sand and the mud, get combined into a single one biotope, which is what we would be looking at analyzing and identifying later. What we're doing now is not necessarily strictly part of the SASS protocol, but very useful in terms of interpreting the data that might be looked at later to understand something of what's happening in and at this site. So we're measuring in situ water chemistry, and we're looking here at the, in this instance, temperature, pH, conductivity, and dissolved oxygen. Now, different instruments vary, and some instruments don't have all of those, some might have more, doesn't really matter. What is useful is recording what you can about a site to indicate and help interpret the data later. In this instance, our temperature, 17.8 degrees, conductivity, 17.1 millisiemens per meter, dissolved oxygen, 8.5, and a pH of 7.1. Second thing we're going to look at in terms of the on-site conditions at this river would be the water clarity. To measure that, we have a water clarity tube or water clarity meter, simply a perspex tube with a flat perspex eyepiece and a movable magnetic disc on the inside. And the idea is that we'll fill up the tube with water from the site, a meter's worth of water. Close that off. Seal the end. And then with the sun at 90 degrees to the tube, we're going to sight down the tube looking for the disc. And when that disc disappears from view as we move this disc down the tube, that'll give us an indication of how turbid the water is. So in this case, it's 9 centimeters, and at 9 centimeters, we lost the visual on the disc, and that gives us the particular clarity at this site. So clear drinking water from a tap would be over a meter. Highly turbid water would be less than a centimeter. So this just quantifies to some degree the amount of turbidity or suspended solids in a water, and we call that the water clarity. Again, another useful measure of the current water chemistry or conditions at the site that we could record onto our SASS sheets to indicate what we found at the site when we were here on this particular day. Right, so we've collected our sample down the river. We've got our three biotopes, and we're going to start tackling our first biotope. In this case, it's very useful to stick to a routine and always start with the one biotope first, and generally stick with the recommendation, obviously different tastes, but stick with those, the order in which one collected them. So as they appear on the SASS sheet, that's the recommendation. So do your stones first, if it occurs, then your vegetation, then your gravel, sand and mud. So in this instance here, our first biotope is our stones biotope. We've prepared it. We're now going to start looking at what's in there. Prior to that, we're going to get the equipment we need for the analysis. And what we have here is an ice cube tray Now, there's many different shapes, sizes, and colors of these, but what's very useful, and we'll see later in more detail, that when you come to identifying certain of the organisms, particularly the Betidae, the mayflies, and the hydrocycids, the caddisflies, you have to be able to distinguish between the different types of mayfly and caddisfly that are present, and we need to look at the total diversity of those overall, but more on that later. And here we've got a pair of forceps, fine tip forceps to allow us to carefully pick out individuals that we may want to look at in more detail, collect samples of, look at features. So zoological forceps, very useful for that. We've then got a little plastic sucker. These come in many shapes and sizes, but typically one that would be useful would be with a tip that can be cut off or adjusted to allow you to suck up little organisms and look at them in more detail as you're progressing through the identifications. Some of them may be fine-tipped for smaller individuals, and in this case a modification of one of those, which has a little piece of netting, mosquito netting or something, stiffened and strapped onto the sucker that allow you to go into the sample, pull out something that you're wanting to look at in more detail, particularly the fast-moving organisms, which evade capture by any of the previous tools we've been showing you. So we've got our basic analysis kit there. We've got our SASS sheet ready to record. We're now looking at our stones sample. The next key thing is making sure, as this is a standardization approach, that the protocol is stuck to, and the protocol for identification is 15 minutes. So we've prepared the sample, now we can start IDing, and we're going to carefully start the stopwatch and get going with our identification of what we found in our stone sample here. So to do that, there's different type trays, might be square, might be round, doesn't really matter. So long as it holds the sample comfortably, you've got some clear water in there, you can see into the sample, we're going to get going with identifying what we found. Picking out little organisms. Sometimes you may need to look at particular features of them. Useful, put them on your hand, the drop of water just to keep them comfortable, and expose the features. Pick up your identification lens and focus on the detail that is important for that particular family. And this is a little beaded. We're looking to the shape of the body, the gill arrangement, shape of the head, and little Betis harrisoni here, which we would now keep to record later the numbers of different types of beta that might be in the stone sample. And it's now 15 minutes, and that completes the identification time of the stone sample. Now, there are going to be occasions when we will be out in the field, we will have found something in the field which we're not necessarily familiar with. For example, this little character here, we're not sure what it is, and we will want to check up on it. Now, particularly when one starts out with the SASS protocol, we want to be able to identify what we're finding. With practice, obviously, it becomes more and more familiar, and one is less reliant on having to identify them formally with guides. But to begin with, this is a very useful publication. It's the Aquatic Invertebrates of Southern South African Rivers. This is the illustrated version of it. Unfortunately out of print, but there is work being done at getting a new series of this available. In the meantime though, we have this, and usefully arranged, we have the different families in their orders. So the mayflies are here, we've got the caddisflies, beetles, the water bugs, the dragonflies, the flies, and so on. And in this case, we've got something here we're not sure about, we would take it out, have a look at it, look at the features it might have, and use the guide in this instance to help us with the identification. In this case, it's one of the dragonflies, so we go to Odonata, and we see here, this character here is one of the Libellulidae, and one can see the similarity between the illustration here and the character on my finger. An important point is that when you come to undertaking these exercises, with practice it becomes easier to identify these things, but under an audit situation where you're having to identify within the fixed time, the time you spend looking around identifying these individuals in the book, if you need to, is still within your prescribed 15 minutes. If you're not familiar with them and it's going to take you 3 or 4 hours, that isn't a standard SASS application of the SASS protocol, and it's not a standard SASS result that comes out of that. So the 15 minutes is very rigorous, and that is the time prescribed to identify and look at the books if you need to.
Having tipped out the tray, another important thing to do at the end of it is to quickly have a scan over the tray to see if anything's been left behind which may not have been recorded on the SASS sheet earlier. Typical sorts of things there would be the leeches, got an example here, and we don't have an example on this particular one, but other things would be ancylids, freshwater limpets, maybe water pennies. So those sorts of things sitting on the bottom, covered by stuff, possibly missed on the identification under the normal time protocol. Quick scan for the particular biotope, check what's there. If it's an additional and not recorded, note it on the SASS sheet.
Probably one of the most common mistakes that get made in the application of the SASS is how to handle the so-called betids, mayflies, and the hydrocycids. Now, you will have remembered we had our ice cube tray, and the procedure we applied was that we took representative examples of the different betids we found in the stone sample. We will have put them into a little well in our ice cube tray, and likewise with the hydrocycids into the little well on the ice cube tray for the stones. For the vegetation, we would have done a similar thing, representative examples of each of those two families particularly. Now the critical thing is we need to know in total for this particular site the different numbers of species of the hydrocycids and the betids. To do that, we quickly take out our examples of those different organisms. We may need to use the hand lens again. We'll have a look at them, check for facial features, particularly on the hydrocycids. And even though we may not know which particular hydrocycids they are, just so long as we know that they're different features in the identification of these organisms, that's sufficient to be able to distinguish between them, to know how many different species there are of these different families. So we work through our sample, we look at the stones, we'll see how many different betids there are, how many different hydrocycids there are, and then at the end of that process we need to know very carefully how many there are in total for this particular site. And I'll show you in more detail of that when we look at the data sheet and filling that in. Now, not to forget, earlier when we were down at the river, we were doing our hand picking and visual observation. This is the time, or even earlier at the start, it doesn't really matter, so long as one does record it, that we would make a note of those individuals and organisms that we found down at the river, for example, the gyrinids, the whirligig beetles, where we found them. So gyrinids are coleoptera, and we would note them under gravel, sand, and mud. They may not have occurred in any of these samples here, but we did find them at the river, so in this instance it would be important to note them as such on our data sheet. Other things that might have been there that weren't in these samples would be the porifera, the freshwater sponges, water pennies and silids, little freshwater limpets, which didn't necessarily land up in the tray, or in the net rather, and then in the tray, but we certainly found them there. We want to record them at this site, and in that instance, we would note them on our data sheet at this point, having gone through the trays. Now, what happens if we find some small individuals which we're not sure about? So this might be one of the examples of a damselfly here. It doesn't look particularly easily identified. We might consult our book here to see if we can try and pick it up and see which one it is. If, having looked at the book, spent a bit of time on it, it still evades identification and we're struggling, the thing to do there is we need to take an example of that either back to the laboratory or wherever our workstation is, where we can work at it, put it under a dissecting microscope. But even that may prove difficult. In those instances, we'd want to then submit it to a specialist or an expert. And in this case, we would have a little sample vial, something like that, a little pill vial, and collect our sample of our unknown species or family, plonk it into the vial, add some ethanol, and we'll look at the ethanol later, exactly what concentrations and so on we're using. Add some ethanol to the sample and seal it. Having collected our unknown sample now, it's preserved in ethanol. What is vitally important is to note the details, firstly on your SASS data sheet, that you've in fact collected a sample, having identified it as far as possible. In this case, it's one of the damselflies. A little sketch of that damsel that you've recorded here would be useful to help link it back to the sample. But in this case, it's also important to, for all of them, to note on a piece of paper which goes into this vial, the date, where it was collected, when, the river, who the collector was, and then that information can be useful for the person who actually eventually identifies this. There are various experts around the country who can identify different families or orders. They have different specialities, but typically a sample like this might land up at the Albany Museum in Grahamstown for freshwater invertebrates. And if they can't identify it, they would send it off to specialists around the world. And that information can be vital to learn about distribution of new species, identifying new species, and being able to expand our knowledge of the freshwater biodiversity in the country. Having started the process of sampling, there are occasions when, in an example like this, we've just started the process, we've finished one of the biotopes, and we find there's a large storm threatening. We realize we're not going to get finished in time. What are the options? Well, in this example, we finished stones, and here comes a storm. We're going to be driven out of here, or washed out of here. We need to move quickly. The SASS protocol talks of two different options of preservation. We can either do a cold preservation or a chemical preservation. For the cold preservation, which is the ideal route to go, because the samples will in fact remain alive to some degree, and I'll talk you through that, the sample is kept in a bucket. The excess moisture is drained off that sample, so it's just damp. A lid is placed onto that sample, and that sample is kept either in a cool box, taken back to the laboratory, where it's stored just above freezing, 3 to 4 degrees, and it can be kept for up to 72 hours. Once we're ready for it, we're back in the lab, there's no more threat of this thunderstorm here, well then we would turf it out into the tray, add clean water, leave it for about 5, 10, 20 minutes, allow the organisms to come back to life, and they last remarkably well, and much easier to identify an organism that's still alive and swimming around and having those particular characteristics which help the identification than working with a dead, chemically preserved sample. So that's the first prize, is to look at a cold preservation as described in the SASS method. Failing that, we have the chemical preservation route, which unfortunately kills everything and does interfere with the identification and hence the timing and the ability to use that sample and create a SASS score. If it's been chemically preserved, it cannot be considered a SASS sample anymore. However, if it's been cold preserved for up to 72 hours and kept at just above freezing point, we can still, and so long as we keep to the 15 minutes per biotope, we can still utilize that data in the derivation of our SASS score for this particular site. Right, we've been sampling, we've had a look at our river, now we're going to get on to filling in our SASS sheet. So, importantly, it's critical that we fill in key information on our sheet to ensure that we don't get further down the line and forget certain information. So, what date did you sample? Key. Who the sampler was? Who did the collection? What river system? The coordinates of the site? Well, those are probably the most fundamental, and then some site description of where you sampled, and if it has a project, it needs to be in there as well. Other information that can come back later would be if it has a River Health Program site code that you can fill in. You may have that information ahead of time. Useful to put that in. What quaternary catchment you're in, what ecoregion you're in, and so on. Those sort of things can come later, but in the field, critically the date, who the collector was, the river system you're on, and the site description. Once you collected that information, you can start scoring your sheet. And in this example here that we've just looked at, we had all three biotopes present. And generally, as recommended, start with your stones biotope collecting first, then work through to your vegetation biotope, then your gravel, sand, and mud. And in this instance, if we find something, we would put it firstly as a 1 if we see it first time. That 1 can change to an A if the abundance increases. And equally, if we find it's very abundant, we might be able to change that to a B. As the directions and the procedures are given, that you have to estimate your abundance. So it's either 1 for 1. If it's an A, it's 2 to 10. If it's a B, it's 10 to 100. C would be 100 to 1,000. And if it's a D, it would be greater than 1,000 of those particular organisms seen. Not often that you would get up to a D, but there it is. How do we handle those cases where we might have seen something at the site, but it didn't land up in the net or on the tray? That's really covered in what we would call our handpicking and visual observation. How do we record that on our SASS sheet? The recommended way would be to note it on the SASS sheet in the biotope that it was most closely associated with, and just put a ring or a circle around that, noting that it was collected, and to distinguish between actually present in the tray or just simply noted at the site visually or by hand picking, you simply put a circle around that particular family. So in this example, it was the whirligig beetles, and those are often whizzing around on the surface, but we don't always have the opportunity or are lucky enough to catch them because they're moving so quickly, but we can visually see them. So we saw them there, and we simply note them, put a circle around it as being present at the site, but not necessarily in our sample tray or in our net. Once we've done that, we would note the biotopes that were sampled. Those would need to be indicated and rated. And that rating is from a 1 to 5, where 1 would be
a really marginal biotope, so it would be hardly there, but you were able to sample it. And a 5 would be an absolutely perfect biotope with all the elements that you were looking for in that biotope, that particular habitat that you're sampling, all the elements would be there. And if it wasn't present at all and unable to be sampled, just a straight line through that box. And also to note whether hand picking and visual observation was undertaken, a tick in that box. Finally, in this column here, you would note the time, actual time spent sampling stones and current, and the standard is 2 minutes. So those details would need to be noted in your sheet up here. When it comes to calculating the scores, we would look to extending into the total column whether or not the abundances were the same as was indicated in the individual biotopes, or cumulatively did they amount to a larger abundance. So in this example, for the freshwater shrimps, we had a single one seen in the stones, a B abundance in the veg, and an A abundance in the gravel, sand and mud. Overall abundance would be a B. And so we go through, we would tick and record into each of the total columns all of the abundances as was seen overall, and from that information we can then calculate the SASS score for the site. How to calculate the SASS score? Very straightforward. The SASS score is simply the quality value as seen in the total column. So in this example, for our flatworms, they were a quality value of a 3, and they're always a 3. They were present, there's an A in the total column, so that 3 gets noted. And then oligoketes are 1, so that'd be 3 plus 1 plus freshwater shrimps and 8, so 3 plus 1 plus 8, and so on. And we simply sum the total in the total column and transfer that across to our SASS score. That would be the sum of all the total quality values projected into the total column, added together, and we get a SASS score of 210. Number of taxa is again very straightforward, and that is simply adding the numbers of taxa that would have been seen across all of our families, and we just note that total number in the number of taxa column here. Right, so we've got a total score, total SASS score of 210. There are 32 families noted at this site. 210 divided by 32 gives us 6.5. So very straightforward. Get the total SASS score, divide by the number of taxa, and that gives you the average score per taxon. In this instance, 6.5. And those are the three key metrics that come out of the SASS5, and which are then used in the interpretation of the data and to give some indication of the health of the site. Other additional information that might be required on the site form to indicate what's happening here. You might have indicated that a particular additional sample might have been taken and collected for further analysis or identification. You would note that. You would note any other comments or observations at the site, whether there was a dam upstream or littering and so on, like that, all that additional information which might be useful in interpreting the data. If there's been any riparian disturbances, so has there been clearing at this site? Have they been removing alien weeds, that sort of thing? Are there cattle coming through grazing? Again, you would note that in the riparian disturbance. In-stream disturbance, has there been sand mining? Those sorts of details. Now, probably what's one of the most common errors that's coming up in the application of the SASS5 method is how to handle betids and hydrocycids, particularly the species. Now, we will have collected into our ice cube tray representative samples of the different betids in the stones biotope. Again, representative samples of the different betids that are present at a site in the vegetation biotope, and again in the gravel, sand, and mud. Now, coming to fill our SASS sheet in, we are going to, in this particular example, for example, we found there were two betid species in the stones. There's only one betid species and a single individual of that in the vegetation. And in the gravel, sand, and mud, we find that there are more than one, it's an A abundance, betids in the gravel, sand, and mud. The problem is now, overall, how many betids do we have? And that's where it's critical to go back to the ice cube tray, look at the total number of individuals that were found across the entire site, and that figure is what gets noted in and on the SASS data sheet. So in our example again, if we come back to it, one we were talking about here, we had two species in the stones, only one species in the veg, only one species in the gravel, sand, and mud, but overall we had more than two species. So it's important then to note more than two species on our data sheet for betidae. It's exactly the same situation with the caddisflies, the hydrocycled caddisflies. And in this example here, I haven't completed it, we'll do it together. We've got only one species in the stones, only one individual in the gravel, sand, and mud. But if we go back to our tray, ice cube tray, and check the actual diversity of species in the tray, we find, in fact, that it's not simply one species, there were different species in the stones and a different species in the gravel, sand, and mud. And in this case, it would have been two species we found, and we would note that. So critically important, a common mistake in SASS5, and something you really need to understand and make sure you don't make a mistake with. Another common error that takes place in the calculations and the filling in of the SASS score sheet is when it comes to the calculation of the scores, is that on occasion there are instances where the stones total scores worked out, the vegetation total scores, and the gravel, sand, and mud total scores, and the numbers of taxa and the ASBT are calculated for each particular biotope. And then everything may go wrong there, because people have been found to average each of those to get the one for the total column. They may choose the highest or the lowest, and so on. The correct procedure in terms of the calculation of the metrics is to utilize what's in the total column only. There are rare occasions where you may have to try and, for a particular site, work out the particular metrics, the SASS metrics for the individual biotopes, but that's a rare occasion and one needs to note that. Those don't necessarily constitute the SASS score though for the site. The SASS score is on the basis of the total column. SASS score, number of taxa, and ASBT.
After spending the whole day in the river today, with the practitioners like Mark Graham and the team, I'm very confident that the DVD we are going to produce will be very helpful in demonstrating practically how best to take the samples and how are we going to have a standard way of doing it across the country. I'm very pleased to have committed experts in the country who can just do this job as beautiful as it was today. Thank you very much, guys. Carry on. This country needs people like you. Thank you.